in specifics, not the usual
politics. Well, what do you want to talk about? What I want to talk about for a moment. Everybody sit in, you all know, thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you. We've got some serious things to talk about. We don't have a whole lot of time, so what I'd like to do is just chat for a while. Stop, and we're going to do a little bit of discussion.
Yes, please start.
Here's the serious issue. We live in a nation in which, to a significant degree, media is controlled by large multinational corporations. We live in a nation in which 95% of talk radio is right-wing, including in areas where Republicans have almost no support. We live in a nation in which conservative Republicans own their own television network. And that is why the work that many of you do in terms of blogging and on the internet is extraordinarily important, because you are presenting an analysis of what goes on in America and a vision of where we should go that corporate media does not present. And I thank you very much for that. The other point that I want to make is some of you have come here to say, wow, we are courageous and we're really on the fringe and we're leading all this stuff. I want to give you some bad news and some good news. The good news is that what most of us believe is exactly what the vast majority of the American people believe. Some of us for years have fought to raise the minimum wage. Some of us believe it should go to 15 bucks an hour. And you know what? Wall Street Journal poll, question that I'd like to speak for a few minutes. I was told that
a couple more minutes and then we're going to get a little shorter than that. But go ahead, and then we're going to get to specific questions.
And the issue is that it is.
Yeah, hold on.
It's okay. Listen, I don't have black lives, of course, matter. And I spent 50 years of my life fighting for civil rights and for dignity. But if you don't want me to be here, that's okay.
No, sir, we want you to be here.
All right, the issue that we're talking about is that we live in a nation which has more wealth and income inequality than any major nation on earth, and worse than since 1928. And maybe it's time we did something about it. We are living in a nation in which the top 1/10 of 1% owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. Maybe we did something about that. To have a government which represents ordinary Americans and not just powerful and wealthy campaign contributors. And maybe that is why it is time to overturn Citizens United and move to public funding of elections. I have not made promises during this campaign, but here's one I will repeat to you, that any nominee I make to the Supreme Court will have to pass a litmus test, and that litmus test is, overturn Citizens United, restore democracy to America. When we talk about issues like Black Lives Matter, let me tell you something. A study just came out a few weeks ago talking about youth unemployment in America, an issue we do not deal with as a nation. And here's what that report said. What that report said is that if you are a high school graduate and you're white, the unemployment rate is 33%. If you are Hispanic, the unemployment rate is 36%. If you are African American, the unemployment rate is 51%. And in my view, maybe, just maybe, it is time to invest in jobs and education, not in jails and incarceration. So let me conclude my remarks by just saying this. I am probably the only presidential candidate who will tell you that no president, not Bernie Sanders, not anybody else, will be able to achieve what has to be done unless there is a political revolution. We need a mass movement of the American people to say very clearly that enough is enough. This government, this country belongs to all of us and not a handful of billionaires. Thank you very much. Because we have a system in which, as I just mentioned, over 50% of young African-American kids are unemployed, are out of the streets, and where we have right now, it is estimated that a black male baby born today stands a 1 in 4 chance ending up in the criminal justice system. So what we need
to
do...
I'm about to get to that.
I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to transform economics in America so that we create millions of decent paying jobs. We're going to make public colleges and universities tuition free. We're going to raise the minimum wage to a living wage. We're going to transform our trade policy so corporate America invests in this country and not low-income countries around the world. That's what we're going to do.
So let me unpack that even more, because you talk a lot about... Wait a second. You talk a lot about economic inequality, right?
I do.
But hearing what's happening here, clearly in this country, we have not fully confronted the racist systems and institutions, right? That coupled with economic inequality is getting us to the place that we're at. How do we do that better? How do we talk about this situation?
Well, it's not a question of talking about it, it's a question of doing.
Well, yes, but what specific proposals?
Specific proposals
in terms of,
well, specific proposals offer a slot in creating an economy where people have decent jobs at decent wages. And that's why we are talking about a $1 trillion program to create 13 million jobs, rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure. That's number one. Number two, when you talk about the criminal justice system, we need fundamental reform in police departments all over this country. I was the mayor of the city of Burlington. And what we moved toward was community policing, where police officers are part of the community and not seen as an oppressive force. And we've got to do that as well.
So I read about, you know, you said that you've been fighting for civil rights, you were there in the March to Washington. Can you point to any legislation in the past 10 years that you've supported that have benefited the African American community and communities of color in this
country? Sure. Many.
Can you name a couple?
Yeah. We built in the Affordable Care Act, which is providing health insurance to many millions of Americans. We got a provision in there, a $12 billion provision, which expanded community health centers all over America, hundreds of new community health centers, most of them, or many of them, in low-income and minority communities. That means that millions of people who otherwise would not have been able to access health care are now getting health care, dental care, mental health counseling, low-cost prescription drugs. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Governor Maui has embraced debt-free college. Do you support debt-free college, including cost and tuition?
I have gone further than that. If you look at, well, not going into the governor's position, this is my view. We introduced, do I support it? I introduced the legislation. This is what the legislation would do. At a time when we have hundreds of thousands of bright, capable young people who can't go to college for one reason, and that's because their families don't have the income to send them to college. That's pretty crazy stuff. And that is why I've introduced legislation that does two things. Number one, it says that all public colleges and universities in America will be tuition free. Number two, what I said, which is equally important, is that we have in this country millions of people, including, I expect, people in this room who have very, very high college debts. Is that correct? And here is the insanity of that. We have people who are paying interest rates on their college debts of 8, 9, 10% at the time when you can refinance your home for 2 or 3%. So what we are saying in our legislation is that people with college debt should be able to refinance substantially lowering their interest rates.
I'm sorry. Unfortunately, we have to wrap it up.
Yeah,
thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you all very much.